episode 21. Here we are. We got a special guest today, Mr. Kevin Weeks. How you doing, Kev?
Good, how you doing?
Speaking of the microphone, watch out, Bundy. Keep an eye on him, all right? Gets a little squirrely sometimes. That's why I brought Bundy.
I'm afraid of Bundy.
What would you do if you had $1 million?
You know,
I tell you what,
that's a real nigga shit, your real nigga story.
Two chicks at the same time, man.
This beat is so bitch.
Ice like a bunch of narcotics. There we go.
I know we got some mutual friends, and on St. Patrick's Day, I was over at someone's house, and he come by, he knew I was there, he come in, and he's like, "Where's Bundy?" I'm like, "Wait a minute, Kev, you know Bundy?" He's like, "Oh yeah, I love Bundy." That's when I said, I got to start getting rid of Bundy, I think. He's starting to steal my thunder a little bit. But we're back. I was away for a week. I was in Florida. A few things happened, unfortunately. Like, I was just speaking with Kevin and Bundy about it. I hate to even give this guy any more publicity, but he actually got his book published, Sean Wick, which is just a travesty. Who we'll touch on him a little bit, who called Kevin his Uncle Kevin and a few other guys, saying he was involved with, actually, I never heard anybody call Whitey Bulger Jim except you. Yeah. I've seen you in interviews, so he must have stole that, he must have stole that from you, and obviously he's saying he was, nothing adds up, and I keep it's like beating a dead horse, right? His timelines and everything else where, it was just impossible, basically, right, for him to even be involved in any, martial motives and this and that.
Everything he said's a lie.
Yeah.
No one knew.
Yeah. I mean, I knew that right away. I didn't know it for fact, but just listening to him, for a few minutes, I knew he was a complete stroker, Like saying he's involved in Winter Hill. I mean, when was Winter Hill gone out of Somerville? And
78, when the racetrack fix come down.
That's in there.
And then from there, it went to Lancaster Street. And then Lancaster Street, they wired it up and bugged it and everything. And then basically we were over South Boston. And most of the members of Winter Hill were either on the run or in prison.
Yeah.
So, I mean, there was no to speak of Winter Hill at Marshall Motors anymore.
Yeah.
I mean, in my lifetime, and I'm 15 years older than this kid, and I was only over there twice in my life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it don't even make sense. Yeah. Lancaster Street, if anyone who's ever read any of the local books, obviously, about Whitey and you and Steve Flemmi and all that, Lancaster Street was the garage that the state police bugged. And then John Connolly who tipped you off?
No. Here's the thing. It was a state police lieutenant that tipped us off.
Really?
He was good friends with Stevie. And he was in a real sensitive position. And anytime, like, wiretaps, things like that, they had to get authorization, approval for the money and everything.
Yeah.
And it went by his desk.
Wow.
So we knew the place was wired before the wire actually went into effect. They like to blame, Connolly and this one. And there was another guy that was involved with Jerry and Jewel. He used to do all the debugging for him and stuff.
Oh, yeah.
This is NASA or something like that. And he was involved, and he told us that it was bugged. So
you had to come from every angle.
Yeah.
I remember reading the book. I actually read I read Black Mass. I was in detox. I was in Spectrum. But I remember it's one of those books, like I'm a true crime guy anyway, one of those books you can't put down. And especially because, if you're from the area or you know a few people or, I'm from Lowell, obviously. I'm from outside of Boston. But still, when I'm seeing a movie and it's based in Boston and, I know that. I know that area. I know this. It's just, obviously it's cool when you're reading something you know about or, even if you know some people on the fringe of it, it's,
Yeah, I mean, it was a movie. It was geographically, chronologically wrong. And the incidents that took place were wrong. Things that happened.
The book or the movie?
Both.
Really? I read the book. I've never seen the movie.
Yeah.
I just saw a clip the other day where you're outside a bar and that. And that's the only thing I've ever seen from the movie.
And who they got playing me? Jesse Plemons.
I don't even know who he is.
He's got tits like a girl.
Yeah, so I've never seen it. I've never seen the movie, you know? But yeah, getting back to that, going back, like, you know, some people, we were talking earlier, like some people, you know, say, oh, rat and this and that. And like, can you explain to us, like, you know, what happened exactly? Like, it was only...
Oh, I got pinched. And, you know, I found out what happened was really is when I went in, pinched, I had a couple of lawyers. The first lawyer, I filed them. He wanted $120,000 for the bail hearing, which was like 3 days later. And then he wanted $20,000 a week for court. And he wanted me to pay for all the expert testimony and appeal and all this stuff. I said, how long is this going to last? He goes, I don't know, 4 months. So quickly, I goes, you're talking like $650,000.
Yeah.
He says, yeah. I says, you're fired. He goes, what? I goes, you're fired. I said, I'd rather give the money to my wife and kids than give it to you. So he was fired. So shortly thereafter, another lawyer came out to see me, a real good friend of mine. A good friend of all of us. He represented, he was basically a mob lawyer type thing. And Richie Egbert.
I was going to say, Richie.
Richie's a great guy. Right? Richie's, about three or four years ago. Yeah.
Jesus.
Great guy. You know, he came in to see me. It was funny. They got me in the room and he comes walking in and he lights up a cigarette. And the guy says, you can't smoke in here. And she goes, yeah, all right. He starts puffing away. Like, I'm just laughing because I know he's leaving. I'm going to take the shit home. So anyways, he says to me, how you doing? I says, good, Richie. He goes, how's it look? He goes, He goes, you're fucked. I says, okay. He says, nah. He says, I can beat off these charges, Kevin. He says, but the ones they get you on, he says, you're going away. He says, it's over. I says, okay. He says, you know, they don't have Whitey and stuff, and they're upset, so you're the man. You're going to get it. I says, okay. I said, I don't need my hand held. He goes, no, I'm not saying that. He goes, I'm just telling you. He says, and there's a superseding indictment coming down on about 28 murders. He goes, and you're named in half them. I goes, all right.
Wow.
I don't know how that's coming down, but anyways, he says, I would never tell anyone. He says, of any client of mine, he says, I would never represent. He said, I'm telling you straight up front. And he gives me this binder. And it's about 3-4 inches thick. And it's all 302s and everything on Whitey and Stevie and everything. He says, read this. He says, you got a lot of thinking to do. He says, those two guys don't care about anyone but themselves. He says, and you're going to take it. I says, all right. So he left. So I read everything, and I was, you know, Stevie
must have
was
been fucking shocked.
You know, I mean, I knew like a year and a half ahead of time that they were informants and stuff.
But, oh, really?
Yeah, come out in 97.
Oh, there was something
I got
in the pinched
in 99. Oh, you know, right. No, Stevie said it on the stand.
Oh, you got pinched. Oh, okay, all right.
Yeah, he said
it
on the stand, and he also mentioned my name on the stand.
So that's what got you.
So
kind
then
of
they come after me, you know.
Yeah.
So. I read everything, and I'm reading it. I mean, there's stuff in it about friends of us, people we had done things with, people that went away for the things they said and everything, and I'm going, you dirty. So I'm I go up for a visit. I think it was my brother or something that came to visit me. And I can walk him downstairs, and I'm in the Wyatt, when you come out of the visit room, you go down to a sally port, and then there's like 4 or 5 doors where you go to different parts, you know?
Yeah.
And so
you and Buddy know the system.
Yeah, so I'm in there. And this other guy comes in there, he's there and stuff. And he's from Rhode Island, if I'm, you know, a guy and everything, he's in there. And he looks at me and he goes, I was bigger than him. He looks at me, he goes, hey, you Kevin Weeks? I spin right around, you know, put my hand, here we go.
You're on point.
He goes, no, kid, take it easy. I mean, I was 43 at the time. He was late 50s, early 60s. He says to me, listen, kid. He says, you're going to take it up the ass for them, too. He says, they've been ratting on everybody. He says, and this is where I first heard the saying. He says, you can't rat nor rat. He says, they're giving up everybody. He says, and they're going to stick it to you.
Right.
I says, dirty. I said, okay. And that was it. And I left going back to my pod. A couple of days later, I get a letter from Stevie. My case is going good, and good luck with yours. So it was like the bottom of it, you know? And I'm saying, nice one. I'm saying to myself, this mother, you know. And then I find out he's trying to make a deal. They sent the second in head of the Justice Department down to Boston to the federal courthouse. I think his name was Mike Coffey. And tried to make a deal right there with Stevie.
Right.
You know, work with us. You've been working with us all this time. Give us, you know, give us what we want. You do 5 years. You get the five. Stevie's got nothing left to give.
Yeah.
Except for Whitey, Steve, myself, you know, other murders and everything. Because right. Johnny had already made a deal, you know. I'm saying it's fucking, you know, knowing that letter, my case is going good. Good luck with yours.
Right, right.
That's what I said. Fuck this.
Yeah.
You know, I had to beat him to the punch, and which I did. And my deal was, you know, you want Whitey, Stevie, you want law enforcement, you know, that kind of stuff. Fine. I says, anybody else in the street or anything? I says, you know, I get nothing, you know. And they were like, no, we got what we want, you know. I mean, they did ask me questions every once in a while. Yeah, I got 72 months, so I did 5 years, 4 months.
Yeah.
I remember the day I got sentenced. It was right after my birthday. And they're going on and on. This is where I told you, level 54 and all this shit. I'm going, got to get at least 15 here. Right. You know, okay.
And that was your first arrest.
Yeah, but, you know.
It's a high wake up.
So I knew it was going to come someday, you know.
Why was the level so high if that was your first? Like, explain to people the levels. Like, if your first arrest, you were level was, one.
My first was category one.
Yeah.
Because it was my first arrest.
All right.
And then the levels go up for the crimes you commit.
All right.
So it goes up to like a level 48 or something, you know. So when I was in there getting sentenced, I look at the paper, and I'm a level 54.
Yeah, that's not good.
I says to my lawyer, he goes, it only goes up to 48. He goes, oh, you got enhanced. I said, what did I get enhanced for? He goes, 5 murders in the managerial position. I go, shit. But, yeah. So the prosecutors actually did a real good job for me. They really helped me out a lot, you know. Even John Durham, he's in charge of the big investigation that they had on the Russia hoax and all that stuff.
Oh yeah, that's right. I read that name. Yeah.
You know, he come up, double one come up from Washington, D.C. and stuff.
Wow.
And they spoke on my behalf, and the judge listens. He goes, and Michael Sullivan, who was Attorney General at the time,
yeah.
He wanted me to do a minimum of 20 years. Wow. He was adamant about it.
Yeah.
And when you got in the courtroom, he was sitting over here to the left by himself. And all of his ASAs and everything else, they were all sitting behind me and over to the right away from him. And the judge was looking, you know, like, what's this?
Yeah, there's obviously some friction there.
Yeah, so anyways, he says to me after everything, Mr. Weeks, he goes, 72 months. He said, I wish you the best and good luck. I said, thank you.
And that was the end of everything.
Everything. I turned to my attorney. I goes, I got 10 months left. He goes,
oh, yeah, you know. Yeah. Oh, all right.
So they would keep me up here. And I said, let's go back. He goes, I'm going to get this whole way. You know?
Did they send you to Devon's or they send you far away?
Oh, back out to Pennsylvania.
All right.
You know, I was out in Allowood, Pennsylvania.
All right.
So.
Well, there you go. Yeah. During all that time, did Whitey reach out to you? Or did you hear anything from him? Any messages from anybody else?
No, I lost contact with him in 96. He had left in December of 94. Stevie got pinched January 95. And I was in contact with Whitey. You know, I was meeting him in Chicago, New York, and everything.
Really?
Yeah, yeah. And so in 96, I lost contact with him. He didn't call me no more, maybe. And I think he knew what Stevie was going to do.
Was
going to
come out that he was a rat, right?
Yeah, and then he didn't know how I perceived it. You know, right. So he just saw contact with everybody back here, as far as I know. You know,
and the next time you saw him, before I had you on, of course, you know, I Google you and check out a few things, and obviously, I always knew who you were and everything. But you know, before I come on, like I was telling him before I come on, I always think I'm gonna have this list, like I'm gonna ask these questions and do this. And I'm like, I gotta be more professional doing this because I always, and then I never do anything, and I just wing it. But when I was Googling you, it come up where you saw him in the courtroom, and would you call him a fucking rat or something, and you had some words.
I was on the stand. I was testifying. And his lawyer, Jay Connie.
J.W. Connie.
As soon as you got him, I said, he's gone.
He's a bum. Yeah, he's a bum.
He's you know, he's the patron saint of the last causes. He is.
St. Anthony.
I don't think he's ever won anything.
St. Anthony. You know,
not lost objects, lost causes. Yeah, you know? Yeah. So,
yeah, I know. My mother prayed for St. Anthony when I lose something. But yeah.
My wife is like that, too. So, and then he gets up there and he had, before the trial even starts, he says, yeah, my client did this. But he didn't kill any girls and he's not an informant. I'm like, you fucking moron. You just pled him out to everything. Said he did everything. Except he was an informant, which is all the paperwork and everything else. Yeah, you know?
Something you can't deny.
And then killing girls. Well, you can't say he didn't kill girls because I was there.
Yeah.
You know? So I was on the stand and they were asking me questions and I'm answering them and stuff. And about a girl, Deborah Hussey.
Yeah.
Well, he choked her out, snagged her, and then Stevie put her over her neck and twisted it and stuff, you know, with the garrote. So, and then we buried him in the basement. So, he looks at me and goes, oh, and so Connie says to me, nothing bothers you, Mr. Weeks. Just said towards the end, I goes, you don't know what bothers me. You got remorse for nothing. He says, you don't know what I have remorse for. Nothing bothers you at all.
Right.
I goes, yeah, one thing bothers me. He goes, what's that? I says, we were killing people for being rats, and I was next to the two biggest.
Ooh.
Whitey looks at me. He's only 10 feet away. He looks, he goes, you suck. I goes, fuck you.
Right.
He goes, well, fuck you too. I goes, no, fuck you. And I jumped up. Yeah. I says, what do you want to do? I says, you couldn't beat me when you were younger, and you still can't beat me. You fight. And the bell's going, and they're banging the gavel and stuff. And then Connie says to me, what if I called you a rat? I said, I'll tell you what. I said, why don't me and you go outside? I says, you call me a rat. I says, and see what I'll do to you. He goes, physically? I said, oh, yeah, I'll hurt you. he goes, oh, yeah, in terms of Julie. Yeah, he's repented. She's changed and stuff like that. And that was the end of it.
Yeah, he's tried to bait you a little. Yeah. Tried to bait you a little, make you look bad. But, yeah, stuff like that. I mean, you know, you've seen some stuff, whether it was, you know, Barrett and all the other ones and just digging up bodies. It's great, you know, to the know. For us, I mean, I couldn't imagine having to go back somewhere and dig up bodies that were buried 20 years ago. I mean,
my stank. Yeah.
Well, that was, I mean, one body was in there for, let me see, about 3 years.
Really?
Yeah. And that body had actually mummified because the guy that gave us the lie, he's dead now, but he got certain, this lie, he's supposed to be hot lie, and it wasn't.
Wasn't
the so right we lie. Poured it on him and everything, it basically mummified him.
Wow.
So when we're taking the body out, the head actually snapped off.
I hate when that happens. That happened to me and Bunny, but we can't talk about
that. Yeah, so then another guy that was there threw me the head. And I look at him, like, you ain't looking too good. So, and, you know, we put him in the bag. And then the other two bodies was John McIntyre and Deborah Hussey.
Yeah.
Deborah Hussey was the freshest. She'd only been there about 6 months. The other guy, McIntyre, had been there about a year.
Right.
So when we're taking out Hussey's body, digging that up.
It didn't stink or nothing.
Well, what happened was, the other body didn't stink, but this body, we were digging out and they had a pick and stuff, you know, trying to get around as we could pick it up. I figured it's going to come out like that one. And I threw the pick in and it was caught and I couldn't get it out. So I started pulling and pulling. Well, what it was, it went in the abdominal cavity. And when I pulled it, it just wide open. And oof, that was it. That was terrible. Huh. You know, I mean, really, it was bad. And, you know, we went through it and stuff, and then we buried the bodies, you know, like Halloween night before Halloween.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah, I mean, I think back, it's not funny, but it was, you know.
No, it's not funny.
It was whether being caught or not, you know.
Yeah, and you were, you know, you weren't out there killing people, you know.
Well, I was involved in you know, everything, you know.
I mean,
I was down there for, you know, I called it in Halloran and Donahue.
Yeah.
You know, McIntyre, as if, a matter of fact, McIntyre, when he came in the house, I grabbed him by the throat and took him to the ground. And then Jimmy stepped out with the machine gun. And the other guy, who was the only one I felt bad about, Bucky Barris.
Yeah, you know, I read that and I think the same thing. This poor prick was just a safe cracker
and was
making money. And they, you know, a lot of things.
He robbed the Medford Depository Trust, you know.
I remember that, Clemente. And who was the one? I was locked up with one of the guys briefly. It was the guy's name Franny. Do you remember that? Was it Franny? Larry, maybe?
Jackie Gillen. There was a few.
One guy, I was not that one, but yeah, what a score that was.
Yeah, well, you know? Whitey and Stevie wanted a part of it.
Yeah.
And they went to Bucky and told him that, you know, they had their money in there and stuff like that, and they wanted him. So Bucky went to Frankie Salemi. Frankie Salemi, who was doing like 17, 18 years for a bombing that him and Stevie did.
Yeah, the lawyer.
Barboza's lawyer.
Yeah.
And so Frankie proclaimed to him, he's with me, and he gave Frankie $100,000. So they had to back off, but it never sat well with them. So then when they finally saw them, it was basically he was coming out of his parole office. And Jimmy was going over there. Right here in Dorchester.
Oh, there's one at Quincy Center.
We used to be next to Lambert's.
Oh, yeah.
So we were going up there, and Jimmy was going to get tickets. You know, he's going to take a trip or something. And Bucky, unfortunately, was walking down the stairs. And you see him, Whitey, and hey, how you doing? Blah, 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 and you're talking and stuff. That piked up his interest all over again. So I set up Bucky where he was going to come meet a diamond dealer and stuff like that, guy that had hot diamonds and stuff. And basically, that was me. So when he walked in the house, I shook his hand and stuff, you know, hey, how you doing? And Whitey stepped out with the machine gun.
Oh, sure.
That was it. And, you know, then they took him down, they robbed him, whatever, went to his house and stuff. And then he got killed. So, I mean, I was a part of different things and stuff.
Yeah, you can tell, you know, stuff bothers you. Obviously, shit, you know.
Well, that was that bothered me is because after he was killed and everything, I come upstairs. He was killed going down the stairs to the basement. And I come walking up, and his wallet was on this, like, end table. Something was open.
Yeah.
And there's a picture of a little blonde-headed girl. She was like 2 years, killed me, you know, because I just had my son, my oldest, and I was like, what the fuck? And that's what I said. I go, and Stevie looked at me. He didn't like it, how I acted, you know?
Right.
And I didn't know this 2 years later. He told Jimmy, he's got to go.
Really?
Jimmy goes, what?
Just something so.
Yeah, he says, he's got to go. He says, I don't like the way he reacted. Jimmy says, what are you talking about? He says, the guy's done so much with us and everything. I mean, Stevie goes, no, he's going to go. And then Jimmy told him, he says, you touch that kid. Because I was younger then.
Yeah.
I was in my 20s. He says, you touch that kid. He says, I'll kill you. Stevie went, what? He says, I'll kill you. He says, there's no reason for you to bother him at all. He says, he's fine. We did more stuff and I was fine with everything, you know.
I wonder why he took such a shine to you. Like, you see surveillance photos. Whenever you see, and there wasn't a lot. Whenever you'd see photos of Whitey, you know, down Castle Island, those were like the only ones I saw, the Lancaster Street Garage. You were always with him walking around. And much older was he than you?
Well, let me see. About 27 years old. I mean,
How'd you meet? Bouncing? Is that the story, I think?
Yeah, I mean, I worked down Triple O's. He used to come in all the time. And we just, hey, how you doing? That was it.
You were a fighter, Joe. That's why.
But he was always, how you doing? How's everything good? And then over the course of time, he'd have more and more conversation with me, And then one day he picked me up, and I hop in the car with this other fellow, and we drive, and we pick up this guy from a bar and put him in the car. We drive down to M Street, and Whitey turns around and cracks him, right? So I start hitting him. And the kid had a sap on him.
Blackjacks.
And he was stuck in his belt, and Jimmy pulled out and started swinging that at him. Well, I'm punching him. He hit me in the hand and broke my hand. I mean, I had a goose egg like this. So he broke my hand. So afterwards, we take him, we drive back to the bar, and we throw him out in the street. And four or five of his friends come out of the bar, you know, and I'm standing outside of Whitey. Hey, what happened? So, and one of them comes up, one of these brothers, and he goes, Kevin. I went, boom. Yeah. And he goes out. I go, what? And they're all like, no. So a week later, the next day, Whitey gives me $1,000, an envelope. But a week later, we found out it was the wrong kid. Uh-huh. This kid supposedly slapped his niece, and it didn't happen. Uh-huh. So this kid had beaten over nothing. So then a week later, we were driving. He picked me up. We were driving up Broadway. And there's someone walking down Broadway, broad daylight, like a Saturday. Beautiful day out and stuff. And this guy was walking by, and he says, the reason I'm not telling you the people's names is because I don't want to embarrass them. He told me this, that dirty. I jump out of the car and I give him a beat right on Broadway in front of everybody. We get in the car and we drive away. Now, back those days, no one said nothing.
Right.
And there was no phones or cameras and stuff. And we drive away. I see him the next day. He gives me an envelope with $5,000 in it. So in the course of a week, I've made $6,000 beating up two people, which I was doing every night down Triple O's for $25 a night.
Real good money then. Real good money now.
Yeah, I says to him, you want anyone else beat up? And he started laughing at you. So, and then, over time, we got closer and stuff. And then I started bookmaking.
Yeah.
And the bookmaking, that led to... loan shark and extortion. People can't pay you, and but I never beat up anyone over money except for one person, and he told me to go F myself. So that was it for him. But I mean, and plus I knew all the people I was dealing with. So
he actually beat up a friend of ours. Spike, a long time ago.
Oh, Jesus.
He hit him with an elbow. Spike did to your sisters. That was our guy, me and Bundy. That was our guy. When we heard that, we were going to come looking for you, but then somebody told us that probably wasn't a wise move.
I seen him down the store. Actually, I was talking to this guy, Lenny, who's dead now, and another friend of mine, Michael, and we're standing there and we're talking. And, all of a sudden, this kid comes walking. You're a good sized kid, Spike, and stuff, So I'm just talking, and he says, Kevin, can I talk to you? I goes, yeah, what's up? He says, I'm sorry about that thing with your sister. I goes, my sister? He goes, yeah. He says, I kicked the dog. And I goes, really? I goes, you're the one? He goes, yeah. I went, boom. I should have wanted to grab him. And that's what, and Lenny, nice guy, Jewish guy, little guy and stuff, He was a loan shark and he was paying me, And he just looked like, I gotta go, Kevin. And he's rude. And my friend Michael looks at me and goes, that was nice, I can call me shop.
Yeah, I told him, I said, Spike, you picked the wrong dog to kick, apparently.
Kicked the dog, but then he started yelling at my sister and stuff.
Yeah.
I think my sister would have beat him.
Speaking of the surveillance photos, and one of them, Gary Bowles showed out, boy from Boston, on Instagram, and Tommy Allen. Actually, it was Gary Bowles who did it.
Okay.
He superimposed Sean Wick in the one with you on Castle Island, and you have a Yale sweatshirt on.
Oh, that was Columbia Park. The reason I wore that shirt is because I had two brothers that went and graduated from Harvard.
Yeah, me and Bundy both have two brothers that graduated from Harvard.
The city happened. So I used to put that on and stuff just to,
Ivy League. But two brothers that graduate from Harvard, and you end up, doing what you did. What a, where are you from? Old Harbor, Old Colony?
Old Colony. I graduated from Penn State. I mean, State Penn.
Yeah.
The funny thing is I had a scholarship to go to Harvard.
Really?
Yeah. Basically, it was because of my brother's, legacy type thing.
Yeah.
And I had to go to, I had to go to school for another year. And I went for like 4 months and I quit. I said, this ain't for me,
Yeah.
And that was it. And then I hooked up with him full time. You know?
That's fucking crazy, though. Yeah. I mean, I don't give a fuck if your brother's on the Harvard. Obviously, you gotta have the fucking the brains to go to fucking Harvard.
I wasn't stupid, but it was, you know, I wasn't on the same level as,
yeah,
you know, scholastically.
What did they end up doing? And how did they? how did they think of your career choices? Were you, always close with your brothers?
Yeah, they supported me my whole life.
Awesome.
My whole life, they supported me. You know, I mean, when I was away, I didn't have to worry. Every month, there was a check in there for my canteen.
Yeah.
You know, when I come out, they helped me. I stayed with one brother for about a month, and then I got my own place and stuff. And they put the money down for it and paid the rent and stuff. Oh yeah, I got a good family.
No, it's good.
I really do. It's strong. My, you know, we grew up close, the kids. My father was kind of a. It wasn't a nice man.
No,
no, he was
drunk or what?
No, that's the problem. He didn't drink at all,
so he had no excuse.
You know, he was ranked a middleweight back in his day and stuff. Oh yeah, he was a tough bastard, and he didn't believe in spamming the rod. You know?
Yeah.
I mean, I'd be sitting on the couch, he'd walk by and kick me in the shin. Yeah. And I'd go, forward, and smack me in the face. I'm like, what's that for? He goes, that's for nothing. I'll do something. I said, okay. Yeah. he was a tough bully, really.
Yeah, bully.
You know?
My father's father was like that with him, and my father never laid a hand on me. And sometimes I think maybe if he would have cracked me,
I've never touched my kids.
Yeah, you go one way or the other.
I've never touched my kids because I've seen what happened, you know, with me. I think it made me more aggressive. You know, we're always in fights and everything, you know. But, I mean, my oldest boy, he's 41, and thank God I never hit him. He's 6'6" and a half, and he's strong as an ox. And my other one, he's about 6'2". But they're both good boys. Never been in trouble or anything.
Good.
Yeah.
Yeah, it must have been tough, you know, a lot of it, you know.
It was what it was. I don't blame him. I had a good childhood.
Yeah.
I mean, because where I grew up in the projects, there was a lot of kids. We were all friends. We all played and everything, you know. Give us a half ball and a stick, and we're all set for the day, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just... Back then, we entertained ourselves.
Yeah.
We had fun.
Yeah, it's so different now with the cell phones. The kids don't go out and play no more. They don't do nothing.
They don't interact with each other. Yeah, no social skills.
Yeah, sports. Unless you're good, you know, good parents, get your kids involved in sports, this and that. The kids that are lost, that don't have anybody in their life, they're just on the phones and they're not in the gym. You know, you see it at the fights. You see everything. You know
everything's,
what I mean?
Everything is expensive today. It is. I mean, my kids play hockey, you know. Not really. They just started skating and everything. But I mean, you know, when you have to buy
the boys,
every year,
the boy,
his daughter,
his kids. That's all. Yeah,
yeah.
His two boys. Pads, oh my god!
All this stuff. You know, I mean, every year you have to get, you know, new stuff on them because they're grown. You know, play baseball. You know, you got to go out every year buy
hockey,
them this and
real
that.
Expensive.
Hockey's real expensive.
And you know, the whole nine.
Soccer. Really. You know, I mean, but it costs you to put them in the league. And I got three of them.
Really?
And they're 8'7" 6".
All boys?
No, two boys and a girl. And my oldest two are boys.
His son's saying to me, I saw my dad on YouTube. And I'm like, yeah. How about the Red Sox?
Yeah.
He was in court. I'm like, oh. I'm like, Kevin, you got to keep the phone away from me.
I hide my phone. Oh, yeah. You know? Then he says to me, he loves zombies.
Yeah.
You know, cartoons, movies, everything. So he says to me one day, he's laying in the bed next to me, and he goes, Dad, he goes, don't you worry. I says, what? What, Max? He goes, if you ever get bitten by a zombie, he goes, I'll shoot you in the head. He was 6 years old at the time.
Right.
I goes, what? He goes, yeah. He says, I won't let you become a zombie. He says, and if I don't have a gun, he says, I'll stab you. I said, thanks, pal. I appreciate it.
This
kid's
already
planning on taking me out. They make me laugh.
I saw something with my daughter once. She was like, I got cussed at her when she was 6 when I got out, and she's 15 now, but she was like 8, and I still have the piece of paper. And she wrote down something, you know, ideas. And I have two sober homes. Turn Mike, she always called me Mike, turn Mike sober homes into women's sober home. Then the other one says, take over roofing business. I said, what are you? You know, you're like fucking 7 years old. You're plotting my demise already. I saved a piece of paper. It was hilarious. Showing all my friends are like, what the fuck's going on with her? She's planning for the future, apparently. But going back to the bank robbery there with Bucky Barrett.
Yeah.
Did you know who Bundy's father was?
No.
You didn't know his father, same name as him. He hasn't seen him since he disappeared, and apparently he's dead now, they think. Right. Same name as him, Robert Dussault. Him and Chucky Flynn robbed the Mafia Bank in Providence, Rhode Island. Yeah. They stole $30 million in like 78. But I don't know if Patriarchy got most of that dough. That was a funny story.
Yeah, but. I mean, Chucky Flynn's away. I think he's doing life now.
Chucky Flynn died. He died like 10 years ago.
He was from the Merrimack area.
Yeah. Was he?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I thought he was a Somerville guy.
No, I mean, he was down Somerville, but he was up in Merrimack. He had that house up there wrapped up.
Yeah.
You know, and he was involved with, I think it was the Ferguson brothers or something. They robbed somewhere, bank or something.
Ferguson?
Not the same.
No, different.
No. They're a lot younger.
That one, Rhode Island, they robbed
Richie Ferguson, I think his name was, you know. And anyways, they all got pinched and stuff and went away.
Stole a ton of money in that one too, right? He's done some scores.
I'm surprised, though. Banks don't have money in them anymore.
Did you see the score in L.A. over the weekend?
Yeah, 30 million.
Cash.
Yeah. 30 million in cash over Easter Sunday. And in this day and age with alarms and cameras, I read that. I'm like, 30 million. See?
Do they know where Sean Hicks was?
Yeah, I know. Apparently, he's the prime suspect.
If he's just here.
Him and Uncle Kevin.
It was him. I know. Uncle Kevin was here. he was the brains behind the operation.
Yeah, imagine a $30 million score in this day and age. You just don't hear about it anymore. Once in a while, you'll see some transport van with gold, like somebody followed it, and they jacked him on the side of the road. But to do a B&E and get $30 million in cash.
Those big heists, but they were usually over in Europe.
Yeah.
Not a lot here.
Yeah.
You know?
You don't see it over here anymore. You don't see the armored cars or anything.
Where was that?
Los Angeles.
Yeah. They went through the side of the wall.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, you see how they got boarded up.
They went to the roof and then they came out the side. Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Had the alarms turned off, everything. So, I mean, they knew what they were doing.
Nice sledgehammer.
That's probably where they had a van or a truck parked outside before they come out the side of the wall.
Yeah, what a score. So, when you got out, must have been tough for you, being, who you were and coming back to this area.
No, I went back.
But I mean about, we were talking about getting a job, looking for work.
Hard.
I mean,
That was hard. I mean, had a lot of friends out there and stuff. They tried to get me, jobs, stuff, because I was on federal parole, and it was right out of Washington, D.C., the Justice Department. Wow. Even though my guy was here, my parole officer, but it was overseen by them. And for a year and a half, I couldn't get anything, I mean, people try to get me, and I'd go in and fill out the application, and next thing you know, they get a phone call. Hey,
right.
In a couple of weeks, we can't do nothing, And that was fine. So finally, a guy named Chris Murphy, who was a BA out in 609 out in Framingham, a friend called him up and stuff, and he says, yeah, send him out. Sorted out there.
Demo? What's the
It was just labor.
All right.
So I went out there and I went to work and stuff. And at the end of the week, he come out to see me. He says, Kev, I got to let you go. I says, okay. He says, okay. He goes, yeah. I says, I just appreciate you giving me the opportunity. I said, no one else would. He goes, really? I go, yeah. He goes, Jesus. He shook my hand and stuff. He says, I'm up for election. And the people got put the articles in the paper about you being out here and stuff. I says, I understand. I says, no, I just, I just appreciate you, what you did for me. And then about a month later, I was home, and my phone rang. And I go, hello. And he goes, Kevin. I goes, who's this? He goes, Chris Murphy. I goes, oh, hey, how are you? He says, good. He goes, listen. He says, I got reelected by a landslide. He says, you go back to work tomorrow. And that was it. And I worked like 6 years as a laborer. You know, I never missed work. I always went and everything, did my job and stuff. Matter of fact, the woman come up from Washington just to check the job site that I was out there.
Make sure it wasn't a no-show.
Yeah.
You know, I was actually in a hole, and we were putting rock anchors in, and you put grout in them, and the grout shoots out and everything. It was like August. I'm filthy, rotten, dirty. All you could see was my eyes and nothing else, right? So she says, oh, he is working. Yeah. And then 2012, I got hit by the excavator.
Oh, really?
Yeah, the guy wasn't really, you know, it wasn't his fault. It wasn't my fault, but I had stopped him so cars could go by. And then I turned the other way to let the traffic come the other way. And he thought swung I was done. He swung around and hit me right in the back.
Ooh, lucky it didn't hit your head.
So I got operated. I ended up with 6 plate, 26 screws and 3 rods in my neck.
Really?
Yeah.
That wasn't some Fugazi fall down and sue the company.
No, it was a real thing. So anyways, I ended up having to retire and stuff,
Yeah.
And the insurance firm, they fought me unbelievable.
Really? Yeah. I didn't say. You must have got a nice,
they shot them, all right. Well, what I did was, they wanted to settle for peanuts.
Yeah.
And I said, no. I said, you know, my lawyer was the one, actually. Right. So, no, this is the rest of his life.
Yeah.
Excuse me. So, they said, well, we'll go to court. I said, all right, we'll go to court. So, I had seen two doctors, my doctors.
Right.
The lawyer sent me to. The insurance company sent me to see their two doctors. And here's the funny part. All four doctors wrote reports that were similar, that I was
legitimately injured. Usually their doctors
are going to try
to make it like it was nothing.
The lawyer tried to argue that. And the judge goes, well, I'm going to send them to my doctor. So he sent me to his doctor.
Who did?
The judge.
Oh, really? I never heard of such a fucking.
So you would have think this guy was a, you know, my brother or something. The report he wrote up was unbelievable. And the judge looks at it all and he says to the lawyers, he says, well, I think you should get together and see what you can come up with. He says, I can't tell you what to do or anything. He says, but I will make my decision in 30 days. You know, he says, if I don't hear from you, you'll hear from me.
Oh, so they knew they better come with something.
No. They just walking out, the lawyer says to my lawyer, he said, we won't hear from them for 6 to 9 months. They're so backlogged and everything, which they were.
Right.
But what he didn't know is this judge was retiring and he was winding down all his open cases.
Oh.
In 30 days to the day, he sent out his ruling.
Got it,
Everything went in my favor.
Nice.
You know, so now they give me, instead of taking a lump sum, because that, it's gone. You know what I mean? You get it, and then you start, getting this, getting that, whatever.
Yeah.
So what I do is I took an annuity where they pay me every month for the rest of my life.
Perfect.
I can't complain.
No.
I mean, would you change it? Was it the injury? Like, does it still fucking bother you?
I've lost a lot in my right arm.
Yeah.
You know, because of the nerve injury and everything and stuff.
Keep that in mind, Bundy. He's only got the left hand now. He's only got the left. We don't got to worry about. The right. Yeah. He might have a little something for you, Bundy. Though I don't know if he's gonna be using the fucking dick beaters for you. Might have to go back to the drawing board for you. But
Oh, you couldn't eat. I don't want to get hit by it.
I heard recently, well, not recently, a year or two ago, that you were actually getting a little trouble down Castle Island or something.
It was June. Not even a year ago.
Hell yeah. Bundy.
I had my kids in the car, my three babies, and I was taking them to Castle Island to go to the park. And as we come up with the, I don't know if you're familiar with Castle Island, but as you come up, there's an entranceway that goes out to the Sugar Bowl.
Yeah.
And there's, lines there for people to walk. So I pull up and I stop because there's a woman coming across the street, And as she goes across the street, I'm stopped. Well, she's in front of my car. This car is behind me. Whips around.
Right.
I'm beeping the horn. So, evidently he doesn't see her or whatever, So he gets past it. So I start to go. He starts leaning on his horn on me now. He's up front. Whatever. So I keep on going and it cuts me off. And I got the three kids in my car. I go, all right, go a little further. Cuts me off again. I said, okay. Now I just back up and I wait. And he goes in Castellani, parks. Evidently, he's not from the area because he doesn't know Castellani. It's one way in, one way out. So I pull him behind him and I park and I get out of the car. And my six-year-old jumps out of the car. Max, he goes, let's get him, Dad. I said, get in the car. I put him in the car. So I get out of the car and I start yelling at him, you know, what are you an asshole? But, you know. And all of a sudden, he comes up with this can of mace, pepper spray. He goes, I'll spray you, dude. Dude. I was like, what? He goes, I'll spray you, dude. I step forward. I goes, what are you off? And he sprayed me.
We've all been maced. That's no fun.
You might have got banged up a little bit. And then when I left, I had to drive home because, you know, my eyes and everything and stuff. And I got pulled over by the state police.
He called the cops on me.
Yeah.
I don't know if it was like a bystander who just called the cops.
He called the cops.
He pressed charges on you?
Yeah.
Really?
So the cop knew what happened because he seen me. He wasn't there for the incident, but he seen me with all the pepper spray and everything. Right. You know, my kids are in the back yelling out, he pepper sprayed, Daddy. He says, you want to press charges, Mr. Weeks? I goes, no, I'm not pressing charges, you know. He goes, well, he wants to press charges. I said, good. I guess then we'll go up South Dakota. I don't know his name and address.
Right.
In the state, oh, you can't do anything. I said, I can do anything I want. I said, he started it. It wasn't me. I says, but, you know, it doesn't end because he wants it to end. So anyways, 6-7 months later, I get a thing in the mail to go to court, assault and battery and assault with a deadly weapon. And I'm saying to myself, I'm more like a spray. You know, I'm 68. I'm a senior citizen. So we go up to court, and we walk through the door. I know everyone up there. Hey, Kevin, hey, how you doing? Yeah. You know, and guys are working now. Kids, you know, growing up behind me.
Yeah.
You know? So anyways, go upstairs for the hearing in front of the magistrate, and he has a lawyer with him. And he comes walking in with a cane. I'm like, are you kidding me?
How old was he?
About 32.
Jesus.
So his lawyer must talk to someone because he went up to them and he told them he stands up at the thing. And they're all going to testify, raise your hand. I wouldn't raise my hand. I'm not testifying. This is just in front of a magistrate, you know? And, well, you don't have to. It's your right. I says, yep. So his lawyer gets up and he says, we'd like to dismiss all charges against Mr. Weeks. Good. And the magistrate looks at me and says, Mr. Weeks? I goes, yeah, sure. What do I care?
That was the end of it.
That's what happened.
Jesus. Where was he from?
I heard him talking to the lawyer saying something about Garden City.
In Jersey.
Yeah, I guess he transplanted up
I was
here
just hoping you didn't say Lowell Bundy. You know, I was like holding in my breath.
I got a lot of friends up Lowell. And,
you know. Yeah, speaking of that, I was going to bring Dickie, and I got caught up
there.
I'd
love to see Dickie.
I talked to him last night, too, because I thought he was coming on.
Dickie's a great guy.
He's going to get pissed at me. Actually,
you want to see it, though.
Now you got to come to Lowell, Kev. Yeah. Kevin fought Dickie in the Junior Olympics and beat him decision? What was it?
We're kids. Don't count.
Dickie lost.
We used to spar and stuff. And everything. Yeah. You know, Dickie was a good fighter.
Oh, yeah.
He had a nice jab. He's rangy and long and stuff.
Exactly. Rangy, clever.
Had a lot of heart.
Yeah.
You know, his brother Mickey has a lot of heart. They were tough kids. His mother was one of those tough as nails.
The whole family.
We go to the fights, his mother be yelling. They're nice people. I mean, you know, I know all their stories and stuff, but I don't care.
Yeah, exactly.
They were friends of mine and they were good people. Who am I to judge anyone? Jesus.
That's for sure. Yeah, they're like family with me, you know. Yeah. Mickey saved my life. Mickey took me down to Florida when I was at my worst.
Yep.
I was on the heroin, methadone, Xanax, alcohol, and Mickey took me down to Florida. I was out on bail, and my thing at the time was I just wanted to come off that methadone because it was brutal coming off that. And, you know, I ended up being sober ever since St. Patrick's Day when I saw you on St. Patrick's Day. It was my 11 11-year anniversary. And, you know, I turned it around, and who would have thought I'd be here with you and Bundy and talking about, you know, the old days and Dickie. And,
I was never a drinker.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, you know, a couple of times I drank, but I mean, I was never really a drinker. I mean, even to today, I probably have like two beers in a year.
Right.
I just never drank. And that's because of my lifestyle. I always wanted to be sober. I always wanted to know what was going on. I mean, so you couldn't relax. I mean, you know, if I went on vacation or something, you know, I went to the islands or whatever, you know, down at Rubu and Bermuda and all this stuff, I could relax.
Yeah.
But as far as being around here, no. I wasn't a drinker at all.
Yeah, that's a good thing. Yeah. You know,
my wife doesn't drink. You know?
Whitey wasn't a drinker either, right? Did Stevie drink or anything? None of them, right?
None of them drank. Thank God.
Yeah, get even crazier.
Oh,
you know, my father. My father drinks. My father's 81. He drinks 7 days a week. And the funny thing about him is, he gets up at 4:30 in the morning and goes to the gym for 2 hours and works out like an animal. Right? He's 81. He still does it. Yeah. And he'll go to the bar at three. I never seen him drink a beer in the house. He'll go to the bar at 3:30 and stay there till like 6:37. Drink like 6-8 beers. Right? Just it's how his routine. It's his routine. You know. And he used to say to me, you know, Mike, some people can drink, some people can't. He's like, it's
my ex-wife. A beautiful girl and stuff, and you know, it was my fault we got divorced and everything. I went away and she was afraid, you know, and then she didn't think I'd change when I come out. So her father used to like a beer.
Yeah.
So he goes to the doctor for a checkup, and the doctor says to him, how many beers do you drink, Rock? He said, Rocco. So he says, how many beers you drink? He goes, I don't know, 30? He goes, what's that in the course of a week? That's not bad. He goes, course of a day. He goes, what? He goes, well, what do you do for exercise? He said, I get off the couch, I walk to the fridge, I get a beer, and I walk back. Hilarious, you know?
At least he was honest, right? Told it like it was.
But you couldn't tell if he was drinking.
Yeah, I met plenty of guys like that. Being my father was always a bartender, being on the bar. Some guys would drink all day, and you just fucking couldn't tell they were drunk. But, you know, sooner or later, it takes a toll on you.
Oh, it takes a toll inside on you.
The beer, not so much, but the people that drink the hard shit, you just see it. Yep. You see it fucking, it kills them.
I know more people that went away because of drinking.
Yeah.
You know?
Stupid shit. You know, I say that, like, I own the two sober homes, and, you know, guys now, a lot of guys are on medication or marijuana, and I say, I don't give a fuck about marijuana, but you're not going to drink. Like, weed, I don't think, you know, people don't smoke weed and get in the car and, you know, beat up their girl.
There's no violent crimes and stuff.
Yeah, none of that. So, but the booze is fucking terrible.
Well, a couple of friends of mine, they robbed a bank, Salty Savings Bank, drunk.
Right on Broadway, is that the one on Broadway?
Yeah. And he was a dangerous guy, too. He's dead now, but he comes out of the bank, he sits on the front steps, and he falls asleep. I think he went away for about 6-7 years or whatever.
That's a good one. I wanted you to bring your book on. There's a book, and I went to get it off Amazon, and my car got declined. I switched the car. So I got to change it, but it's Brutal by Kevin Weeks. It's a great book. Like I said, especially when you're away, we read all the, you know, Johnny Monterano has a book, Hitman. You have a book, Brutal. And I wanted to bring that up, but I heard you're writing another book.
We just finished it. What's today? Saturday? I think we finished it Thursday night.
Really?
So it has to go to the editor and all that stuff.
All right. When's it going to be available? Any idea?
I have no idea. You know, it's called Jewel Thief, but you know, I have no idea when it will be out.
Yeah.
I mean, that's beyond me.
Well, I just wanted to, you know, bring that up, you know, hopefully, you know, pump that book up. It's a, you know, it's a book by a real person, even though it's a work of fiction. Like that other book should be that he's claiming and everything else. But I don't want to keep talking about him, but people like.
But if you look at he's 15 years old and, you know, he's going to Northeast New England.
Yeah, upstate New England. When I called you Uncle Kevin and Uncle Whitey and Uncle.
I mean, I was just like, you know, I was talking to some friends of mine, some guys, and they, you know, and they were Winter Hill guys. They were long before me.
Yeah.
And I was the youngest one. And they're like, I don't even know this kid. No one knows him. I talked to guys that were in the can. I'm talking guys that did like 40-something years and 38 years and 14 years. I mean, they did, you know, good bits and stuff.
Yeah.
no one knows him.
Yeah.
You know?
He's nobody.
Yeah. It's just, you know, remember the Army? They used to have a recruit in the, on TV. And same thing with this kid. Be all you can be. Write a book. Be all you can be.
Yeah.
Just make up and make it up as you go along. Yeah. You know? Maybe that's what we should have did, Bundy.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know how the fuck Blackstone Publishing didn't. But, we're hoping Shelley Murphy, I think her name is.
Yeah. You
know?
Yeah.
Shelley Murphy from The Globe.
Yeah.
We're hoping she does a story on him. But like you said, it's almost like a catch-22. Do you give this guy more attention and people fucking actually buy the book?
Yeah.
You know, people, if you know, you got to go online and just give this book terrible reviews because it's all fiction. Yeah, but
now they're making you buy the book to give the review.
Yeah. But you could go on Barnes and Noble or Goodreads too and give reviews. So whatever you can, give it a bad review because it's total fiction. He's claiming to know guys that, you know, have no clue who he is.
No one. I mean, I said, I talked to a lot of guys that were, you know, in prison and everything, did a lot of time. Serious guys. I talked to guys, you know, that are out now and everything, and you know, the guys from Somerville.
Yeah.
And he's saying he knows you too.
Yeah, yeah.
You're saying I don't even know him.
Yeah.
You're just straight up lying.
I like what he called me too. So I was like,
I
don't want to fucking scumbag.
Do anything anymore, but you know,
die.
Yeah,
I'll do it for you.
Yeah,
if I had the opportunity.
If Bundy, over here, see him. I'm not going to check the guy, but I'm sure Bundy will. But Bundy wanted to go looking for him. He's like, we'd love to bump into him. You know,
no.
Whenever he made the video with some kid like walking around South Boston, like
where? I never seen the video.
Oh, you didn't?
No.
Oh yeah, want to see it?
Yeah, walking around South Boston.
Oh yeah.
I like to know where he was walking around.
What was the?
You know, I talked to people in Southie. I mean, people that were always down D Street, down the projects, up the point. No one knows them.
Nobody knows them.
Oh, I mean, I talked to one guy. He did 47 years for, you know, murder and everything, killed a bunch of people in the can and stuff, too. You probably heard him.
Who?
David Weitzel.
Oh, yeah.
I was with him. Yeah, I was up in the Sioux. I wrapped up 2018.
Yeah.
And he was up there when I was up
there. Yeah. I mean, Dave, you know, me and Dave were friends when we were kids and everything. He was a couple of years older than me.
Right.
And I knew him out in the street until he was like 21. He went away for life.
Yeah.
You know, and his brother. A real good friend of mine.
He got out, huh?
Yeah, he's out, right?
He's getting paid, huh?
Hopefully.
Yeah. All them 30-something years for nothing?
I mean, the state police that investigated, he was on the stand in the previous time. They caught him in like 13 or 14 blatant lies.
Really?
And he started crying on the stand, admitting that he lied.
Who was this?
I
can't find this.
Let me think of his name. Begins with an S.
He was a detective, right?
Yeah, he made it. Oh, Jesus.
So he must have had a good lawsuit, right?
Well, his first lawsuit, he went to court, and I testified on his behalf, you know, where he was that night and everything.
Yeah.
Just told the truth and stuff. And they asked about his relationship with Whitey. I says, Whitey didn't really care for him, you know, for it and stuff. And so anyways, the jury come back and didn't say not guilty. They said 100% innocent.
Wow.
That was what they said. And they awarded him $33
million.
But there's a cap on it. No,
they
didn't appeal at all.
There's
a cap on it in the state.
What is it?
$1
million. Ah!
So that's all you got. But now he's got the big case going, which is no cap on it.
What's that, against the federal government?
Sprague. Sprague was the state trooper's name.
All right.
You know, and they got no, there's no cap on that. So hopefully, I mean, you know, 37 years in the camp for something you didn't do. Oh,
Jesus.
You know?
Yeah. Oh, he's going to get paid.
Yeah.
Hopefully.
Yeah.
Yeah, I couldn't imagine. 37, it's your whole fucking life.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
Your whole life, but the important parts, you know what I mean? From your fucking mid-20s.
Mid-20s right 60. Up until you're almost 70.
Yeah.
Wow.
You know?
Yeah. I mean, you can't put a number on that.
No, you can't.
It's tough to put a number on something like that. You know,
next 20 years, you'll live good.
Yeah.
Hopefully.
Yeah.
You know.
You hungry, Kevin?
No.
I'm going to go get something to eat. Me and Bundy are always hungry, by the way. What's your good restaurant around here? La Scala? What's a good Italian joint?
Good Italian joint? Yeah, La Scala is good.
La Scala.
I pulled up and then I says to myself, you should have asked. Is this in the basement or upstairs? I ain't going in the basement. I've been involved in too many of them.
Yeah,
it's right down here.
You go down first. Well, Kev, man, I wanna thank you for coming on.
No, thank you for having me.
And now I feel like I dropped the ball. I didn't bring Dickie. Dickie's going to be bullshit, so we might have to do it again.
I told you to bring Dickie.
I talked
to Dickie last night.
You should have said something. I'm always last second, you know?
No, I told you at St. Patty's Day. Bring Dickie.
Oh, my God.
This is 21, right?
This is episode 21. Yeah, we got to have you on again. Then maybe I can slowly edge Bundy out and you can be my...
No. There's no replacement, Bundy.
No, there isn't. Isn't he the perfect host?
He is.
So many people say to me, man, Bundy's perfect, you know? So, it was good having you on. I think it was good. We didn't, you know, talk too much about him.
We didn't talk about him. Bubba Yeager.
Yeah, Bubba Yeager. That's from the Sean Wick movie.
Yeah, Boogeyman.
I don't know how anyone could even take him seriously when he's saying all this stuff. Like, I mean, molded me to be this and that. Hopefully,
I'm the scariest person I know.
Yeah, that was the greatest one. Who scares you the most? He's really pondering it. Oh my God! But
I can tell you who scared me. A lot of guys.
Bundy?
Not yet.
Yeah, you were around some real scary guys. You know?
Yeah.
I mean, that's a crazy thing where any day someone could, like you said, Steve, you got to go. And that's all it would have took is 1 second. And then you're with someone, they just fucking shoot you in the head.
Well, what I found out in life is that gangsters kill gangsters for the most part.
Yeah.
You know, and people that are around that lifestyle and that stuff. It's not so much legit people, but it's for the most part.
Your own. It's coming from somebody close.
So, you know, you trust me. You got to trust someone. Yeah. You have to.
Yeah, and you think someone's your best friend, and that's who they use.
Yeah.
Well, that's who gets you. You know, did you find it, basically from when, how old were you when you started bouncing?
18.
So from 18, you went away when you were?
43.
I was going to say 42. 43. So that's all you basically did. You never really worked your whole life,
collecting money and shaking people down. I had a job with the MBTA.
Did you really?
I used to go and work at the T, 80 to 82, something like that. And I went in one day and I quit. And they said, no one quits the T. I said, just quit. Yeah. He said, Kevin, are you serious? You can't quit the T. I said, I'm quitting. Why are you quitting? You know, I'm losing money coming to work. I had everything else going on in the street. I was losing money coming in there.
You know?
I made a great job. I wish I kept it. Hindsight, but you know.
But you did all right. It was good you got in the union. You know what I mean? Yeah. I mean, hate to say it, but it was probably good you got hurt, right? Yeah.
It helps.
You did all right.
Otherwise, I'd still be working.
Yeah. You're working until you're fucking 75. Fuck that. You know?
I mean, I got my social security now.
Yeah.
Because even though, you know, I was doing it, I always kept myself on the book somewhere.
Yeah.
Where, you know?
Yeah.
And I own stores and stuff. So I always had income coming in besides. Good.
A couple hustles, a little coming in there.
Yeah.
A little coming in here.
You know, back then it was like a bucket. Just like it is raining out today. You put a bucket out and all these little drops.
And it fills up eventually.
That's what we had it coming from every direction.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And just every week, you know, you had to empty the bucket.
I got a bucket now.
I got a
bucket now in my sober houses. I put coin op washer and dryers in.
Yeah.
So every once in a while, I encourage the guys to wash their clothes. What?
I got a
bucket on my quarter. Yeah. See that?
You just say.
He emptied it out.
It's under my bed.
I was down in Florida. He emptied it out when I was away. I was down in Florida where Johnny Montorano lives now.
Yeah.
Down there in Delray Beach, which is fucking beautiful. I had a good time down there. I went down there with my girl. My wife, Shin, she doesn't know she's my wife yet, but she is, definitely.
She's nice.
We own a massage place. They still together. It's legit.
But, it's not the old woman tongue.
No. I wish it was.
Bundy would be first in line. Bundy wants to go get a massage.
And then he'd come around and get back in line. Yeah.
Bundy wants to go get a massage. I said, you're going to pay double.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I mean, it's like fucking two guys.
I went to a place one time years ago. My friend said, come on. And I'm talking, I was in my 20s, you know?
Yeah.
So like, I go in and I'm looking at this, you know? And so one of the guys with us, he's older. He drops his drawers and he starts batting the ball, you know? I'm like, what the fuck are you doing? He goes, what? I goes, what are you doing? He says, oh, I want to make it last longer when I go in. I goes, get the that was it. I went outside and waited in the car. Yeah, he goes, get the
I think that would have been enough for me. Is that in Chinatown or Quincy? A lot of them in Quincy.
No, it's actually down on Nantasket.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I was like, you got to be shitting me. You know, see you later. Sick bastard.
All right. Well, I'm going to wrap it up. Kev, thanks for coming on.
Always a pleasure, man.
Thank you. Pleasure.
And it was great meeting you.
That's episode 21. Justin, how we do?
Awesome.
21 in the books.
Like a bunch of narcotics. Pull up in a new Rari. Live it like you got it. Chopping bricks like karate.